that has a singularity. Your heart has a little cavity between the two ventricula of the heart, and that little cavity has the highest electromagnetic field of your body and can be measured up to 8 feet away from you. And that's the battery of life.
Inside there, So I calculated the volume of a proton. It's 10 to minus 39. Depending on which radius you take, it's an approximation. 10 to minus 39 centimeter cube. And I said, how much of this energy that's in the vacuum is still present inside the teeny weeny beady proton? And I made the calculation, which is pretty straightforward. And the result is 10 to the 55th grams within a proton volume. There's still 10 to the 55th grams inside the volume of a proton. Where did we see that number? The mass of the universe. The mass of the universe. Now remember our assumption, remember our statement? The vacuum connects all things. If that was true, that would mean that you'd expect all the information of every proton in our universe to be present in each one of them. And that's exactly how the math came out. Isn't that cool? This is actually the mathematical evidence, I'll call it for now, that everything is one. All right? Now, no longer just a concept, no longer a dogma. Now, it's a mathematical, physical evidence. Like that?
Yeah, right on.
I thought I was...
Don't want to be too obvious in those papers.
I said, oh, you know, this number is evidence that all protons are entangled. Right? You know? If you use physics terms, and they'll listen. And so, this is all nice, you know, this 10 to the 55th gram per proton volume. Remember, 10 to the 55th gram is enough to make the whole universe a black hole. So obviously, if I take all of that as the mass of the unit of the proton, no doubt the atom is a black hole. But actually, how much of that do I need to take? Very little. In fact, if I only use 10 to the minus 39%, a very teeny weeny beady little amount of 10 to the 55th grams of energy, the proton becomes a black hole. The atom is a black hole. And so in this paper, in some ways, you could say that I'm saying that the vacuum is feeding all atoms. That the material world is basically 10 to the minus 39% of the energy of the vacuum. It's just a little beady weedy leak, teeny weeny leak of the vacuum. And it makes up the material world. So imagine if we tap this energy that's in space everywhere, we don't even need to tap anywhere close to 10 to the minus 39% of it. You know, if we tap, just if we cohere that energy, get it to work with us just a little bit, just a teeny weeny bit, we can produce enough power to power a whole planet for thousands and thousands of years. We can produce enough power to create gravitational fields, gravitational drive, travel across our solar system, travel across our galaxy, probably go from one galaxy to another, or even one universe to another. We free our society from the bounds of being stuck to the surface of a planet which is not a really good place to be.
close those eyes. I got a nice surprise for you. Sweet child, can't close those eyes. Never say goodbye. Never say goodbye to you. Sweet child, don't close those eyes. I got a nice surprise for you.
expect in the coming decades. The prospects of technology appeal to people's deepest fears as well as to their highest hopes. A rational debate about the future seems no longer possible. In fact, such discussion, by definition, is beyond our human capacities. Aren't we still too human to be prepared for becoming transhuman?
It is an enormous privilege to be alive right now and to be a part of this movement, and it's a very difficult time. I don't deny that at all. I look at it more as a birth pain, that here is this change that's occurring and we're coming down the birth canal and there's blood around and it's a difficult process, but it's a birth that is occurring. It's not a death. And I think that when future humans look back on this era from several hundred years in the future, they will not remember this time as one when we squandered the resources of the planet, when we destroyed our planet, essentially. They'll look at this as an extraordinary moment in time when we developed the basic technologies, the basis for their societies. We developed genetic engineering, the ability to basically rework our own genetic blueprint, which is something unprecedented. It's never happened in 3.5 billion years of history. We began to move out into space for 3.5 billion years. Life, all of life, has been constrained to this thin film on the surface of the planet. And now, quite suddenly, in just an instant in time, we're moving out towards the universe. And the third thing that has occurred in our era is artificial intelligence, computers. Suddenly, non-living material is beginning to achieve a level of complexity that rivals that of life itself. So these are three things that are absolutely unprecedented in the history of life, and they're occurring now. And is it any surprise that this is something that is jarring and shaking up the environment and causing extinctions? This is going to provide the basis, not just for the next 100 years, but for thousands of years, tens of thousands, if not millions of years.